Okay, very good. We have a cadaver lab set up for Mazor. We're going to demonstrate percutaneous navigated robotic assisted pedicle screw placement in lumbar spine. Real quick, want to thank Medtronic and Mazor, Judd Hunter, and a couple of other folks here who are supporting it. So, you know, it was a really good question earlier in my talk about, you know, what's the big deal about using a robot versus adding it to navigation. So I want to go to the computer screen and we'll try to zoom in so we can show a little bit about the computer planning. So this cadaver had a pre-op CT scan from the thoracic spine all the way down to the pelvis. Judd has kindly planned some screws from L3 to L5. And just want to show you how the software is built that the surgeon can play with and plan, which I do ahead of time prior to the day of surgery. So we're going to go down here to L3, and we can see the screws from an MIS type technique and system that Judd has already planned. I'm going to add a set of screws at L2. It goes up and it will show me the sagittal, the axial, sagittal, coronal planes. And I'm simply going to click a screw, and it's going to add a pair of screws similar in diameter, length, and trajectory to the last placed screw. So that helps with efficiency. And then I just do a drag and drop with my mouse, and I'm going to plan a couple of screws at L2. I'm going to keep in mind the facet joint and try to avoid the facet joint. I'm going to try to put that nice, perfectly planned screw. If I want to change the length, I right click. I can go up in diameter, I can go up in length, and apply it to both screws very quickly. So in that way, planning is very nice, it's very efficient. If you're doing high-grade spondies, we've talked about it a little bit, let's say at L5-S1, we can plan bicortical screws. And so even though you might lose some tactile feedback through the rigid arm, you now can plan and be absolutely certain within 1 millimeter accuracy that you're gonna get bicortical screws, whether it's for the sacrum, for L5, or other applications like cortical bone screw trajectories. In addition to that, we can actually plan the inner body. So I'm gonna go down here to the inner body space where Judd's planned an inner body, and I can go through and scroll. And I can look and plan my screws and fill those pedicles as easily as this. And I can see the pedicle fill both from the diameter and length. And I can verify my accurate screw placement on the sagittal view, so I can see the pedicle screw going down the middle of the pedicle. And then I can go to my inner body and I can change whatever Medtronic type inner body here, and I can simulate what this is gonna look like. I can change it to an 11 tall and a long expandable cage. And what I'm gonna do is take the simulation off and then simulate it. And if you'll watch that right side, you'll be able to see a very quick simulation of what that level and lordosis and height will look like based on the simulated screw. So that's essentially the planning software. I wanna also show the next generation is gonna allow us, which is coming out in a couple weeks actually, we're gonna be able to plan a decortication path. So we'll be able to plan, for instance, in an MIS TLIF, the contralateral facet decortication, and then ultimately a facet fusion. And we know that in many cases, adding a facet fusion or posterior lateral fusion improves our fusion rates compared to inner body alone. So I'm gonna go over here and add what we call a trajectory right now. And typically this is actually gonna be replaced with the new software. And so I'm gonna take this trajectory and move it and pretend like this is going to be a facet decortication tool. And it'll look something like a 7.5 millimeter tool, 20 millimeter length, and that looks like a tubular retractor. But if I save that and take it away, you can see I'm gonna plant it right into that facet joint on the right side. And when I save that, that's now my trajectory that I'll send the robot to when I'm ready to do my facet fusion. We'll send the robot, we'll make a small incision, we'll drop a drill, decorticate the facet joint. Through that same cannula, we'll just deliver 2 cc's of allograft, autograft, or whatever into the facet joint, and within a couple of minutes, do the posterior or posterior lateral fusion. Okay. We're going to sort of demo how it's done. We have the robotic arm set up over here. It's table mounted. When it's table mounted and then it's mounted to the patient with one point of fixation, everything is very, very stable. You don't need to do push-ups or pull-ups on this robot, but it's a very, very stable construct because it's attached to the operating room table. The robotic arm now serves as the reference array for the image guidance. So remember that this robot is a fully independent robot and had a navigation system embedded into it. So if by chance, and we talked a little bit during my talk, if by chance the navigation goes bad or goes awry and you can't reconcile the navigation, you can actually use this robot with 1 millimeter accuracy without a problem. In fact, before they installed the navigation and stealth system into the robot, the Mazor was fully functional with 1 millimeter accuracy. So robotic arm, table mounted. We're going to show you the tools real quick. So it's a very standardized setup for four steps of putting in a pedicle screw. So once we send the robot to the position, it's really a matter of, in an open technique, going in with a navigated dilator and cannula, the navigated Midas for Mazor with power, navigated tap, which you can use the power ease drill. And for the young surgeons, save this motion for opening beers and other things. Whereas you can save your carpal tunnel and your wrist arthritis, and then navigated powered screwdriver. I was very slow to adapt power for my taps and my drills and my screws, but certainly as I've gotten older, I've recognized the benefits of the ergonomics and standardization, reproducibility of using power. So with that in mind, we're gonna send the robot to the left L3 pedicle screw position. And for purposes of this demo, we're going to really demo a MIS perk. Obviously, you can do this open or mini open. The robotic arm has moved. I'm simply going to make a small incision with a big 22 blade down to the through the fascia and down to the spine. And then I'm going to take my navigated dialer and cannula. It's going to go right down the rigid arm. There was a comment earlier about losing tactile feel, and it is absolutely true. You lose some tactile feel working through a rigid arm with heavy instruments, but I would argue that tactile feel will be superseded by the computer planning, the accuracy of the planning, and the predictability of the robot. So we leave the cannula in and take the dilator out. We go with the Mazor Midas. We're gonna look at the screen, wherever it is. And we're going to verify the position of the live instrument in comparison to the navigated screw, which you can see on the back screen. I'm going to pull the drill back and create a pilot hole. That pilot hole has a depth stop of 30 millimeters, so you can't plunge. We're going to take the Midas out, switch it over to a tap. And go with a navigated tap through the cannula. Again, I'm going to verify my navigation by looking at the screen. And tap the pedicle. Going to take the tap out. Going to take the cannula out and place the screw. Again, under power. And I'm going to throw a little bit of a commercial for the all-tap screws. So with a combination of all-tap screws, the way the thread pattern is designed, the tip of the screw associated with using a power, literally the screw just gets sucked into the hole. It minimizes the risk of skiving and then increases our accuracy of placing the screw. Yep. We've got the software loaded with the wrong screw system, so we're going to change that so you can see the navigated image with the screw going in. Tools. There you go.
Dr. Chua.
Yes.
Quick question, why There's a question about why use a tap when you're using the Padrill image-guided robotic. Can you skip that step?
It's a great question. So we have three pedicles planned that I was going to show. This first one is all four steps, including the tap. The next pedicle I was going to show without the tap. The next pedicle I was going to show you where there's no dilator. We're just going in with a drill and then the screw. So I wanted to show all four steps before skipping steps. And so I encourage the residents and fellows to learn the technique and do all of the steps. And then you can learn when you can start subtracting some steps. I'd rather use that term rather than cutting corners. So there is the screw. Thank you, Judd. I'm going to drop this screw in. And then this is an MIS screw system, and the Mazur knows that. So if you'll watch down here as we send it to left L4, the Mazur arm knows that I've put in a screw with some towers, and so it's going to come out of that cone of this pedicle screw before it moves to the next spot. And so at this level, I'm going to skip the tap step, as Kojo had suggested. Make another incision down through the skin, fascia, and down to the bone. And I think the point's been made several times with MIS technique to make sure you get a good fascial opening so that your soft tissue doesn't, or your instruments don't get hooked up or hung up on the soft tissue or fascia. So again, dialer and cannula goes through that incision, lightly touches the bone. Drop the cannula, and you can see on the navigated images behind me, we'll take the dilator out, drill a hole, and then drop the screw. So we're going to skip the tapping step. Again, with power and with the ATS screw, it's very, very efficient and reproducible. And again, dropping the screw. We'll release this MIS screw system, gently remove it, and we'll move to the left L5 pedicle position. And now I'm going to show you place the mid of the screw in two steps. We'll make the incision first. I don't really count this as a step. I guess it is a step, but. So this time we're going to go in with the cannula and the drill together in one step. Drill the hole, take everything out, and then drop the screw. And so there's a pedicle screw being placed with a robot in two steps. And then real quick, I wanted to show, if you'll send it to the snapshot. So Dr. Skaggs, I think, was the one who asked, well, what happens if someone bumps the reference ray? Honestly, with a Mazur, it's pretty hard to bump the reference ray. It's real big. It's kind of out of the way. But if that's the case, all of you should remember there's always anatomy checks that you should do with navigation or robotics. So take your chicken foot or turkey foot, whatever part of the country you are. In this part of the country, it might be a salmon foot, I don't know. And you can do your anatomy checks with your navigation. But if you feel like the nav is off, your current nav systems, you'd have to bring in your O-arm or your brain lab. You'd have to do another spin and re-register everything. With this, all you do is you send the arm to the snapshot position. I have this gingerbread man, and if you'll zoom out for just a second, we're going to add the gingerbread man to the robotic arm. It's got reference spheres. We're going to acquire that shot. And that shot immediately recalibrates and re-registers the nav system separate from the robotic system. So again, a lot of safety features that can help out. And then the final step I wanted to show is, let's say we have the new software and the new tools that are coming out soon. We're going to send it to the trajectory for the facet fusion, which is that trajectory view that I put a little tube on the plan. And again, just envision this as either an open or a mini open, or in this case, MIS. So this is targeted for, I think, L3-4. I'm gonna drop my knife in to just make a perk incision for L3-4. Through the skin, through the fascia. And then pretend like this drill bit is a larger drill bit. It's a 7.5 millimeter acorn bit. And we're gonna drop this down in a navigated way. Oop, it didn't save our original trajectory. Or is it the other level? That's okay. Send it to L4-5 maybe?
It's this one.
Yeah, right.
I didn't know you did.
I didn't know I did either. Yeah. So here's the trajectory for the decortication. Again, small incision. Decortication tool. And hopefully you can see that on the nav screen there. So that decortication tool, if you could zoom in there, as best you can. It looks like a tubular retractor, but that's essentially where we're gonna do the facet fusion. So I'm gonna use this drill and just drop it in there. And it'll have a positive stop so I don't go through the lamina. And then I'm gonna take the drill out and I'm gonna have a special preloaded gun with autograft, allograft, whatever. It's gonna go down the cannula in 2 squeezes. You're gonna drop 2 cc's of bone into that facet. Take the drill out. Now we've done our posterior facet fusion to augment or supplement our interbody fusion. So that in a nutshell is image-guided robotic-assisted pedicle screw instrumentation. Again, the flexibility of the Mazor. So if you're an open surgeon, mini open or MIS, can be used for pediatric all the way to adult, degenerative to trauma all the way up to deformity. Very reproducible, very standardized, extremely efficient, besides the accuracy that we already know that navigation gives us. While there are some limitations, and it's been already pointed out, you lose some of your tactile feedback on the bottom. Again, I would argue studying your pre-op CT scan, using the software to your advantage to maximize your preoperative planning, and then the precision of the robot just makes this part of the operation very routine. And you can kind of spend some of your mental effort doing the other parts of the operation, the decompression, avoiding the spinal nerves and spinal sac, and deformity correction.
Any questions at all? Thank you so much.
Great. Thanks, everybody.